I am truly delighted to welcome you all to this conference and to what we hope and very much expect will be a most interesting day. More than 2,300 years ago, Aristotle wrote, "There is always something new coming out of Africa." It's a proverb that has since also been attributed to the Roman statesman Pliny the Elder. Its origins were no doubt directed to Africa's magnificent wildlife, but in our current times, its significance can be seen to be much wider. And as you all know, the theme we have selected for this conference is Africa Expanding Legal Horizons. That title reflects the fact that Africa is a continent with a rapidly expanding legal market in line with its current rapid economic growth. And in that vein, the topics we will cover today encompass a broad range of issues that are of particular relevance in Africa. But these issues are by no means Africa-focused. The topics under discussion are relevant to and arise in all jurisdictions across the globe. You will today be hearing from many of my colleagues at Brick Court. They are, I believe, extremely well placed to be addressing issues with such an international dimension. Brick Court is, and always has been, an internationalist set with leading practitioners appearing not only in the English courts at all levels, but in overseas courts and a variety of tribunals in a wide number of international jurisdictions. And of course, a very significant proportion of our client base is international. We're also delighted to welcome a number of external speakers. My colleague Harry Matavu, who has been the driving force within Chambers behind today's event, will shortly say a few words about the programme for today and introduce them more fully. But we are very grateful indeed to each of them for agreeing to participate. We're of course delighted to welcome you, our delegates today. We're particularly pleased to be joined by representatives from such a wide range of organisations, including the leading London, UK and global law firms, as well as leading Africa law firms, a wide range of corporations with investments in Africa, major litigation funders, as well as risk consultants, investment advisors, analysts and other business advisors specialising in Africa and emerging countries. You are each very welcome. We would also like to extend a warm welcome to colleagues from the legal press. Legal business, MLX, commercial dispute resolution are all represented today. But of course, my introduction would not be complete without a special mention of the Times, in association with whom we are particularly delighted to present this conference. The contribution the Times has made over the years to the development of the law needs no further elaboration from me. The weekly law section and the Times' broader online offering under the editorship of Francis Gibb truly sets the standard for law reporting in the national press. We're delighted that Francis and her colleague Edward Fennell are here with us today, and I shall shortly be handing over to Francis to say a few words. But before I did so, I just wanted to flag one other thing. Unlike most conferences, there's no registration fee for today's event. This is very much a gathering of colleagues, and we are practicing barristers, not professional conference organizers, although of course I hope today that today's event will be as professional as it can be. But what you may have seen from our conference invitations is that we would invite all of you to consider donating to two excellent legal charities with which members of Chambers are involved and which do very important work in advising policymakers and in a legal capacity building emerging countries. Their names are up on the screen, but just to say a few words about each of them. International Senior Lawyers Project, or ISLP, is a charity of which Richard Gordon is a trustee. It's a global legal charity which provides the pro bono services of highly skilled and experienced lawyers from around the world to promote human rights, equitable and sustainable economic development, and the rule of law worldwide. ISLP assists governments, non-governmental organisations, and other institutions working to build legal capacity. The second is Protomos, of which Alec Hayden is a trustee. It is a legal charity which provides practical legal assistance, education, and capacity building to marginalised communities, bringing together development lawyers from across the world. It trains young lawyers, educates communities on their legal rights, and assists local lawyers to negotiate on behalf of the affected communities and to litigate in local courts. We warmly commend the work of both of these organisations to you and are very pleased to welcome representatives of each in our audience. I'm going to embarrass them slightly by just asking them to stand up so that you can see who they are, because I'm sure they will be more than happy to provide you with more information at one of our coffee, lunch or afternoon tea breaks. Thank you very much indeed to those of you who've already made donations to these charities in lieu of a registration fee. If you haven't done so, please do consider doing so after the end of today's event. In any event, you're all very welcome. We hope very much that you'll enjoy the conference and the day. If anyone wishes to tweet, I'm told there are two hashtags for the event. There they are. Well, no, they're going backwards. There's the two hashtags for the event, and those will appear on the slides periodically during the day. And now it's a great pleasure to hand over to Francis Gibb, the legal editor of The Times.
Thank you, Helen, and especially for those very kind words. I'm Frances Gibb, legal editor of The Times. It gives me very great pleasure on behalf of the newspaper to offer a warm welcome to everyone here today to this conference, in which we're really delighted to be a partner with Brick Court, one of London's leading sets of chambers. The topic couldn't be more timely. Africa clearly offers huge potential economically, but to fulfil that, it requires the rule of law, obviously, and provision of sophisticated legal services. Much of that work is being done on the continent, but there is huge scope for lawyers here in London and in our courts. We've got an impressive lineup of speakers and an excellent programme. Thanks to Harry Matavu and Paul Gray for all the time and effort and work in putting it together. The Times will be covering the conference in our law pages on Thursday, but if I may be allowed a plug, today is also the day, as it happens, that we have launched an additional legal service, which is a free daily news bulletin with comment and analysis for all our readers, lawyers and others interested in the law. And I hope very much that you'll all sign up. It is free, even to non-subscribers. And I think there's a leaflet about it in the packs or around the conference. I think now it just gives me, all I need to do is hand over to the chairman. Welcome, everyone. Wish you a very good day. And thank you all for coming.
Well, good morning. You're clearly all old Africa hands. You keep African time. We're delighted to see you all here this morning. We really are. And as I look around, I see here serried ranks of lawyers, bankers, financiers, asset managers, private equity investors, consultants, and yes, journalists. I suppose in the demonology of the 21st century, one could not find a more lurid gallery of pariahs. And in the midst of this inferno, I even see on the attendance list one or two academics bobbing like kindly turtles in this shark-infested sea, freighted with learning and the wisdom of the oceans. But you are all most welcome, and no doubt we'll see very many more people coming in as the day progresses. So those on this side, make room for them, and I hope we'll have a very interesting day. Some parish notices before we get underway. First of all, the fire exits. Well, they're the doors. The loos are back that way. We've got a very tight timetable, and we'll try to catch up the time as we move along. We hope this is going to be an interactive session today. By that, I mean we're going to encourage comments and questions from all of you who really do have something to contribute, as well as those who are going to be addressing you from the various panels that you will hear towards during the day. Please be involved. We've got roving mics around the place, so if you want to contribute, stand up, tell us who you are, but try to keep your contributions reasonably punchy. The charities you've heard about are willing to take any donations, whether on an individual basis or a firm basis, and please consider contributing as generously as you can. In addition, all of us at Brick Court hope that we shall meet as many of you as possible during the course of the day. Please do talk to us. Having myself spoken to a number of my colleagues over the year, I think I can confirm that at least many of them seem to be reasonably normal. And so we would welcome interaction with you. And please also talk to each other. One of the points of these conferences is that people from different disciplines, different firms, different industries and sectors can come together and share ideas. Please make use of that opportunity, introduce yourselves to each other, and meet new people. And we all hope that we shall all work together in the future hereafter. And so, to the matter in hand. As I designed and developed this program, I adopted a working title for ease of reference with the intention that it could and possibly would change as the program developed. But as the topics began to crystallize, it became clear to me that the working title was in fact entirely appropriate. And it provides a useful compass, I think, for our deliberations today. Africa, expanding legal horizons. It's a title that is intended to invoke the huge skies and the massive scale of a continent which spreads in so many directions and holds so many opportunities for its peoples. Whereas we know economic growth has been double the world average since 2003, and where, as is recognized, a demographic boom has seen the emergence of a young and ambitious population and rapid urbanization, fast-growing telecommunications, and sophisticated markets and finance systems. Where it has been suggested, and I quote, that by 2050, a typical African country like Zambia can reasonably expect to be at worst Poland and at best South Korea. So Africa, expanding legal horizons. It's also a title that reflects the assertiveness and the demands of the peoples of that continent for services, including legal and related services, to meet the requirements of their fast-growing economies and political aspirations. Things have certainly changed, and I'm sorry to say this to some of you in this room, from the days when Cecil Rhodes said that to be born English is to win the first prize in the lottery of life. The same man who said, "I contend that we are the finest race in the world and that the more of the world we inhabit, the better it is for the human race. I would annex the planets if I could. I often think of that. It makes me sad to see them so clear and yet so far." Well, Rhodes died, as you know, at the age of 49, exhausted and defeated by the immensity of Africa, and perhaps by a single-mindedness of vision, which seems to have made little room for humility. And so Africa, expanding legal horizons, a title also intended to focus our attention as providers of legal and other services on the demands of that vibrant and assertive market, demands which stretch in different directions across a huge continent of 54, or is it now, Trivial Pursuit enthusiasts, 55 with Southern Sudan, 55 separate and different jurisdictions. Different jurisdictions with different indigenous and customary laws, different traditions, different colonial legal histories. 55 jurisdictions which cannot, in truth, be viewed sensibly as one unit. And so how do we, as legal and other service providers, expand our own horizons to meet the challenges and opportunities offered by these markets? And Africa, expanding legal horizons, is a title also that seeks to challenge the established and sometimes dismissive commonplaces about the dark continent and the presumed intractability of the political and economic problems that African countries have faced over the last 50 years. Things have changed, friends, and they are continuing to change at a rapid pace. And as Alex Perry has written in his excellent new book, The Rift, A New Africa Breaks Free, he says this, "This old Africa, a continent of aid, dictators, and war, is one with which you are likely familiar. There was even some truth to it in the past, but the new Africa is a place swelling with an angry assertion and pushing back at the false prophets who presume to tell Africans who and how they are. Where once Africans fought ruling powers, now they battle a ruling perception. And where once they deferred, now they defy." And that's not to say, of course, that the problems of Africa have been solved. Of course not. Millions still live in deep poverty, and political mismanagement and corruption are rife across the continent. But these problems are not exclusive to Africa. Corruption is rife in Europe and elsewhere across the world, in politics, in business, in financial markets, and also in sport. And this is a point to be emphasized, that a conference on topics relevant to Africa is not solely about Africa. The topics and problems we shall discuss today are relevant to jurisdictions across the planet. And so I hope the conference will lead us to expand our horizons across the whole of our practices. And as time moves on, let me just introduce very briefly the program for the day. My friends, we shall start with a bang, with a session on the promotion and enforcement of human rights, focusing in particular on the International Criminal Court and the role and importance of human rights in business and investment. And in addition to my brilliant colleagues who specialize in that area of work, we are delighted to welcome to that session Dr. Eva Thorne, who has wide policy-making and advisory experience in the fields of corporate governance and human rights-related issues. And we look forward very much to her insights on the matters that are discussed. Thank you, Eva Thorne, for joining us today. We look forward to your contribution. And then a session will follow on market regulation and competition with some of the leading experts in the field, both in chambers and also from outside. And again, we're very pleased to welcome Jose Costa Pereira, the advisor on policy and communication in the Africa Department of the European Union, who again will give fascinating insights from a policymaker's point of view. And closing the morning session, morning proceedings, we'll have a session on the highly topical issue of sanctions, led by our formidable team of sanctions experts in chambers. The afternoon sees discussions of African cases before the English courts, and then a focus on arbitration, which is increasingly viewed by many as the ideal dispute resolution procedure for businesses and investors. But what is the point of arbitration without an adequate regime to enforce arbitration awards? And that session explores this issue. Ladies and gentlemen, one of the many memorable quotes of the great Hollywood producer Samuel Goldwyn concerned the best way to produce a film. What he said is, "What we want is a story that starts with an earthquake and works its way up to a climax." This conference is that story. From the sessions that you will have heard in the morning and in the early afternoon, we shall close with two very special offerings. First, a session on corruption, where we are extremely honored to be addressed by Advocate Thuli Madonsela, the Public Protector of South Africa, who sits with us today, and we welcome her very warmly to our conference. She has flown in from Pretoria to be with us today. And I hope you will now and later on, but certainly now, give her a very warm welcome. Advocate Madam Sir. A brilliant lawyer and a brave and independent guardian against abuses of power and the misuse of state funds, who has been a thorn in the side of the executive. And she will be joined by Lord Hoffman, an international arbitrator who has been one of our most brilliant law lords of the last 30 years, and Robert Barrington, the Executive Director of Transparency International UK, perhaps the foremost anti-corruption force in the world. Well, there is only one person who can keep order with such forces arranged in front of him, and that is, of course, the peerless Sir Sidney Kentridge, the greatest advocate of our time. So we look forward to that session very much. In footballing parlance, that is a team of Los Galacticos, if ever I saw them. And the conference will close with a reminder that there is a world elsewhere apart from the law. And that reminder will be in the form of a keynote address on global security by a major actor on that stage. Ladies and gentlemen, it is not every day that a conference such as this is addressed by someone of the stature of the First Sea Lord and Chief of UK Naval Staff. And we're very privileged that he has agreed to give up his valuable time to address us, and we look forward to what he has to say both on and off the record. And after all that, we shall all need a drink. Don't rush off. The Hunterian Museum will be the venue for our drink. It's upstairs here. A wonderful museum with fascinating collection of the art and science of surgery from the 17th century. And after a good, warm, welcoming drink, we hope that you shall go from this place, as F.E. Smith said, probably none the wiser, but certainly better informed. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you enjoy your day very much. Thank you for coming. Richard, over to you.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome. My name is Richard Gordon, member of Brick Court Chambers. Harry began with what you might think was a joke when he referred to African time. However, he sent me an email in July telling me the session started at 9:30. I pointed out to him that the programme said 9:15, and he did actually say, well, we're going by African time. So in deference to Africa, we start at 9:30. In deference also to the election of Mr. Jeremy Corbyn, the aim of this session is to engage the audience as much as the speakers. So please do feel free to jump in with questions whenever you want to. But the structure will be that each of our five speakers will speak for about 10 minutes each, and then at the end we'll have time, hopefully, for questions and answers. Let me say a little bit about this session. It is entitled Public Law and Human Rights Issues, obviously with particular reference to Africa. Jeremy Bentham, the great philosopher, said that human rights were nonsense upon stilts. I think what Bentham actually meant by that was not that human rights didn't exist, but rather that human rights are shaped and framed by the state. This is not a conception of human rights that everybody shares. For example, the American delegates in 1787 spoke as if from the 18th century equivalent of cyberspace of a right to pursue happiness. So there is a danger in framing the content of human rights as if, again, to quote from Harry's magnificent starting address, we knew everything like Rhodes. The answer is we don't. The challenge is to devise consensually, if possible, a set of principles which will aid business as well as placing obligations on them. Hopefully some of these issues will be addressed in the session which follows. May I introduce each of the speakers first and then ask each of them to come up and say a few words about their subject. We start with Paul Bowen, Queen's Counsel. Paul is a new tenant of Brick Court Chambers. He practices particularly in the area of fundamental rights and public law. He's a superb advocate with over 100 reported cases to his name. And he, in combination with Professor McCorquodale, the next speaker, will speak about the UN guiding principles on business and human rights. Robert McCorquodale will also speak, as I say, about the UN guiding principles. He's a member of Brick Court Chambers. His practice is centered on public international law, very appropriate for this topic. His vast experience on the subject of his talk perhaps speaks for itself. He's a director of the British Institute of International and Comparative Law, and he's a professor of international law and human rights at the University of Nottingham. Our third speaker, Emily McKenzie, is also a practicing barrister at Brick Court at Chambers. She's going to speak on the topic of investment treaty arbitration and the protection of human rights in Africa. She has an impressive crop of academic accolades, as one now comes to expect from tenants at Brick Court, including specializing in public international law at New York University School of Law and working as an international law fellow at the American Society of International Law in Washington, D.C. Our fourth speaker, Andrew McIntyre, on my left, is also a member of Brick Court Chambers. He specializes in all areas of Chambers work and also has excellent academic credentials. He's going to speak about the International Criminal Court with particular reference to Africa. He's very well qualified to do so. He used to work as a UN legal officer at the Khmer Rouge Tribunal in Cambodia. Before that, he used to work for a human rights NGO in Johannesburg. And last but not least, by the Boolean principle of exclusion, Dr. Eva Thorne is not a member of Brick Court Chambers. Uniquely, that is, for this session. Her subject is highly focused. Its subject is reforming Liberia's petroleum sector. Eva has extensive experience working with the public sector in Africa, Asia, and Latin America on governance-related issues with a strong focus on extractive industries. At the Africa Governance Initiative, Eva worked with the Liberian government to reform its petroleum sector, including its new legal framework, capacity building for the sector, stakeholder consultations, and reforming Liberia's national oil company. Eva holds a doctorate in political science from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology and an undergraduate degree in history from Harvard University, both in Cambridge, Massachusetts. So we should hopefully have a feast in store. May I now call upon Paul Bowen to give the first talk.
Thank you. Thank you, Richard. It's a great honour to be coming ahead of Robert McCorquodale to talk about the same subject. The fact that I'm coming first doesn't mean that I know more than him by any means. I found out why it was, in fact, after I spoke with Robert on Friday, is that I'm doing the boring bits. Robert's going to do the interesting stuff. So I'm going to do my very best to make sure that the boring bits are as interesting and informative as possible. So the UN Guiding Principles 2011 are what I'm going to talk about. In our globalized economy, the governance structures of many of our developing nations, including many African nations, are relatively weak. Profit-maximizing multinational corporations operating within those nations whose activities fall outside the regulatory regimes of their home nation may have little incentive to submit to or to invite further regulation by the host nation. So human rights abuses can occur, and host country governments may be unable or sometimes unwilling to remedy those abuses. In Africa, we've seen many examples, including the destruction of natural habitat and the traditional way of life of the Ogoni people in the Niger Delta, the Marikana platinum mine massacre in South Africa, and the dumping of toxic waste on the Ivory Coast. Occasional lawsuits invoking familiar remedies, such as negligence or nuisance, brought in developed countries against the parent companies of these corporations, have gone some way towards remedying these abuses. And this is the subject on which Robert is going to be speaking. But the cost and complexities and the limited availability of such remedies, together with the issues that they raise around the sovereignty of the host country, mean that they can only ever be part of the solution. So, what about human rights? Human rights traditionally were conceived of as a set of norms and practices that protect individuals from threats by the state, not by individuals, whether legal or natural persons. Human rights treaties can create rights to be protected from the activities of third parties, including corporations, with correlative positive duties on the states to take appropriate measures. So, for example, the right to life and the right to a home may oblige the state to take measures to protect individuals from the polluting effects of some businesses. But even when available, these rights are not enforceable directly against corporations, only against the state itself. Now, for some years, attempts have been made within the UN to translate human rights norms directly to businesses. But these attempts all failed, exposing a deep division between the human rights advocates on the one hand and global businesses on the other, who objected to the privatization of human rights. And it was with a mandate to address this issue that in 2005, John Ruggie was appointed as special representative to the UN Secretary General. 6 years later, he presented his answer to the UN Human Rights Council, the UN Guiding Principles. Now, Ruggie recognized that a treaty process imposing legal duties directly upon corporations was probably doomed to failure, and in any event would be bogged down for many, many years in negotiation. He also understood that human rights can be effective even when they're not legally binding, citing the philosopher Amartya Sen's view that human rights, even when not legally enforceable, have power as moral rights to influence and change the behavior of governments and corporations. In Ruggie's view, it was not necessary to try and impose new duties. What was called for was to make the existing mechanisms more effective. So at the heart of the UN guiding principles are the so-called three pillars. States have a duty to protect human rights, that's pillar one. Corporations have a responsibility to respect human rights. And between them, each of them must together provide effective remedies for any breach. So the first pillar involves a restatement of existing legal duties. States must protect against human rights abuse within their territory. But these are existing human rights obligations. But the fact that the guiding principle merely restates, perhaps repackages, existing legal duties does not diminish their potency in effecting change. So examples of legislation that have given effect to the principle in the United Kingdom include amendments to the Companies Act 2006, which require all quoted companies to include in their annual strategic report information about human rights issues, including any policies of the company and their effectiveness. And now, as a matter of European Union law, the same obligation has been imposed since December 2014 for all companies with over 500 employees. Public procurement is another area. It's specifically provided for under the guiding principle number 6, but the new EU public procurement directive specifically cites respect for human rights as a relevant factor when awarding public sector contracts. And the Bribery Act is a further example, which imposes criminal sanctions on corporations that seek to bribe foreign officials and the innovative offence of the failure of a commercial organisation to prevent bribery on its behalf. So that's the first pillar, the duty on governments to ensure through legislation, through policy, that human rights are respected. Then the second pillar is the corporate duty to respect. Business enterprises should respect human rights, which means that they must both avoid infringing human rights themselves and should address adverse human rights impacts with which they are involved. Now, there are three things to note particularly about this aspect of the guiding principles. First, the term used is should rather than must. So these are not binding legal duties that are being created, but moral duties of the kind I mentioned earlier. They may, of course, be given legal effect by states in compliance with their duty to protect, but in the meantime, corporations will be expected to comply or risk adverse judgment by their stakeholders and reputational damage to their business. This idea is hardly new. In his new book, Connect, the former head of BP, Lord Brown, demonstrates that companies that engage radically with the societies in which they operate are generally more successful than those that do not. And he gives the examples of the Cadbury's and Hershey's businesses from the 19th century to demonstrate the former. So compliance with the guiding principles makes sound business sense. The second point to make is that business enterprises must not only avoid causing or contributing to adverse human rights abuses themselves, but they must also use their leverage to prevent or mitigate abuses directly linked to their operations by those with whom they do business, even if they have not contributed to those impacts themselves. And then the third aspect of this, this duty, the Guiding Principles 15 to 21 require business enterprises to have in place appropriate policies and processes to meet their responsibility to respect human rights. This includes the obligation to undertake due diligence to identify, mitigate, and account for how they address their impacts on human rights, integrating those values and findings into corporate cultures and management systems, and tracking as well as reporting performance. So the guiding principles therefore co-opt familiar business concepts of due diligence and risk assessment and harness them to the human rights project. And then the third pillar, remedy. This requires states by principle 25 to take appropriate steps to ensure access to an effective remedy. Now, the principles do not prescribe a new enforcement mechanism. If a business enterprise breaches an individual's human rights, then there will be a remedy only if one is provided for by some other mechanism. So, for example, a remedy could lie under the European Convention on Human Rights by way of an application to the European Court of Human Rights if the action in question took place on a territory under the control of a European nation, even if it happened, for example, in Africa. A remedy could be brought or sought under the African Charter in the African Human Rights Court itself, although at the moment that is an organisation which has some development to do. An application could even be brought under our Domestic Human Rights Act in respect of breaches of human rights that would have taken place in another country if, as I said, at the time they were under the control of the domestic government. But these are all remedies that lie against the state, not against individual businesses. Liability for human rights abuses cannot be imposed directly upon business. Now, in the UK, for example, some steps have been taken to impose human rights obligations directly upon governments. Just by way of example, under Section 73 of the Care Act, providers of community care services under statutory powers are treated as a public authority for the purposes of the Human Rights Act, and therefore can be directly sued for breaches of human rights. And the courts can also develop common law remedies so as to give effect to human rights principles. But internationally, there are few signs as yet of human rights obligations being directly imposed upon businesses. Although one interesting example, in June of this year, the African Human Rights Commission produced a draft general comment on Article 4 of the African Charter, which is the right to life. And that general comment provides that non-state entities such as private individuals and corporations, including private military and security companies that are responsible for arbitrary deprivation of life, should also be held accountable. I've already mentioned the existence of traditional legal remedies such as the torts of negligence and nuisance. And of course, these may be prayed in aid as evidence of the discharge of the obligations under this third pillar. And Robert's going to deal with those in more detail. But of course, the general principles, it can be said, may have a part to play in the development of those remedies as well, whether judges are being called upon to exercise their jurisdiction to hear such cases, or in deciding whether a duty of care exists, or whether there's been a breach of any such duty. The second limb of Pillar 3 is the obligation upon businesses. Again, not creating binding obligations, but these again are moral rights businesses are expected to have grievance mechanisms in place to give effective remedies. But I'm going to leave that question to Robert. So just by way of conclusion, the general principles represent a pragmatic staging post on the way to an international human rights framework that is binding directly on corporations. They reinforce existing state duties to regulate their own business enterprises when operating in other nations and harness established corporate governance structures along with the moral power of human rights to improve human rights compliance by those business enterprises. But to give some idea of the distance still to travel, I will leave you with John Ruggie's own words from his book, Just Business. The idea of human rights is both simple and powerful, but the operation of the global human rights regime is neither. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Paul. That last quote might provoke some questions in due course. Robert McCorquodale.
Thank you very much, Richard and Paul. You are never boring, and you always manage to deal with very important issues. As Harry's already indicated, that those who are academics are some kind of turtles, and those who are practitioners are some kind of social pariah. I'm not sure which I fall into, being both. Perhaps I'm a turtle with a particularly hard shell. In 2007, company called Amesis entered into a contract to sell IT systems and surveillance to a government in Africa. They thought that was fine. That government was Libya. With the fall of the Gaddafi regime, it transpired that many of the software provided by Amesis was used by the Gaddafi regime in order to target those who were critics, both inside and outside Libya, to torture and to bring a great deal of anguish to the lives of those who are opposed to the regime. An action was brought against Amesis in France for complicity in torture, for complicity in a range of human rights abuses. I start with that example because that is one of many where a company has not thought about the human rights consequences of their commercial activity. And there are now many cases, most of which are being brought in the UK, which deal with corporate activity which raises human rights abuses. And in a way, that's what Paul and I are hoping to alert some of these issues, and the particular focus I want to have is on remedies and responses to them. It's possible to have a remedy before an international human rights court, but that remedy is only available for a state. For example, in Shell's activity in Ogoniland, which Paul mentioned before, the action was brought before the African Commission on Human Rights against Nigeria, not against Shell. So that remedy doesn't lie. But it is possible, in some instances, to have a remedy within the relevant African state, the host state of the particular abuse. However, in many instances, that is not going to be the location, either because the government itself is complicit in the activity, or because there's no rule of law in that state, and therefore trying to bring a case is extremely difficult. There are some exceptions. There's some cases in the South African courts, and I think as the governments begin to develop legislation in this area, that may well be an area of progress. In relation to where most of the other remedies will be, they'll be in the home state. In other words, in the location where the corporation is a corporate national. Now, for our purposes, most of these are going to be in relation to civil claims. Now, there's going to be the first issue that will come up as to whether or not there will be a claim will be, does the court have jurisdiction? And most of these cases are going to be in tort, probably negligence, such as for actions that harm the environment, that harm human rights, that impact on community lives, such as the rights to health, the right to life, privacy, and actions such as false imprisonment and labour rights. Now, Now, within the UK and across Europe, Brussels run, or now actual Brussels run, recast, basically covers any situation where the corporation is domiciled within Europe. And that domicile is not just where they're incorporated. It can be where they primarily carry out their business. So that means there's a much wider scope than there used to be. In the US, there was the Alien Tort Claims Act, or still is the Alien Tort Claims Act, where there are a number of cases brought against corporations for breach of human rights, for example, during the apartheid era, for example, during forced labour in Burma. However, since the Kiobel decision by the US Supreme Court, it's unlikely for this to develop necessarily more broadly because the matter has to touch and concern the US itself. Nevertheless, there are still some cases which are going along that area. And then if you have jurisdiction, as I say, in most instances, that is going to be found by the courts. The question is the applicable law. Now, this is where one needs to know a range of different types of law, not just public international, not just human rights, company law and private international law. Because private international law, as you know, is the area which will determine what is the law that's going to actually apply for the particular circumstance in the particular case. Which law will deal, for example, with the harm, deal with the damages. Once again, we have the position is largely covered by European regulation, Rome II, and Rome II essentially means that the place where the damage occurred will be primarily the place which will determine the particular principles involved. To give you an example, in a Dutch court before the Hague District Court in Akban against Shell, the Dutch court found that they had jurisdiction, but the applicable law was Nigerian law. Why that mattered was Nigerian law allowed an action against the subsidiary, but not against the parent company. And therefore, the Dutch court could not find Shell, the parent company, liable for that particular action. It also determined the level of damages. The final issue is whether there's a duty of care, clearly necessary in tort claims. Well, the problem here is often the corporate veil, normally the courts will not go through perhaps the violator, which is the subsidiary, to go to the parent company. However, there has been a development in this area. In particular, what is happening is the courts are finding the parent company itself had a duty, and therefore there was a direct duty still on the parent company. An example of this is a case called Chandler and Cape involving the health and safety of workers, where they found that the parent company was very much the one that made the policy and directed the activities in the operation of the subsidiary. So it is possible the duty of care is growing at quite a significant rate in terms of what might well be obligations on a parent company. So a parent company, which is perhaps operating through a subsidiary in an African state, could still have liabilities for civil claims if it's shown that there's a human rights abuse. And just to finish on this point, compensation. It's growing more and more the consequences of compensation on corporations, so that although it's very hard often to know the end result because most of these are being settled in the UK, nevertheless, about 84% of them at the moment seem to be indicating that companies are paying out compensation to the victims of human rights abuses in which they're involved. And in terms of the particular additional remedies, we can't neglect employment claims, because employment claims may well be an area which is ones where they fall within this broad area of claims against a company for activities they could be taking in Africa or of course, within the UK itself. And the development by the employment tribunals is an example of that. Just to flag, of course, in terms of immunity, some of the employment tribunals are also going past the state immunity for employment claims against diplomatic missions within the UK. Criminal claims. Oddly enough, not many of these have been taken. A couple are elsewhere in Europe, but there are at least three areas which are possible within the UK. The Bribery Act has made a significant difference on this. It now is possible under the Bribery Act to be found guilty of being involved in an activity where there's, even if it's the act is abroad and the bribery occurs abroad, it is still possible to have a claim against a corporation within the UK. The Serious Crimes Act and the Criminal Law Act are also examples where it includes crimes that occurred beyond the UK. Though, of course, the normal position is that crimes are usually territorial. The further area is the company in company law. The Companies Acts are beginning to change around the world. There's the UK Companies Act, Section 172, South African Companies Act, the Italian Companies Act. They are beginning to include a responsibility on a corporation to report about their social and environmental activities. It is not just a case of reporting on a financial basis, but the financial basis extends to social and environmental activities. Paul's already mentioned the EU regulation on this, which is coming into effect. And of course, there's also the Modern Slavery Act. The Modern Slavery Act is a reporting requirement on companies in relation to this kind of area. The final one just to flag is the national contact points. Not a judicial mechanism, a non-judicial mechanism under the OECD guidelines on multinational enterprises, but nevertheless, in fact, one which is these days becoming much more engaged, many cases being brought before that. Problem is there's no actual enforcement mechanism, but it can be a problem for a company to have to face issues of claims in this area. Having set the scene in terms of the remedies, what are the potential responses? Well, the responses, firstly, human rights due diligence. Paul's already mentioned that Guiding Principles 15 to 21 make it very clear that's what a company needs to do. They need to undertake human rights due diligence. That doesn't just mean having a nice policy and leaving it there. It's a much deeper requirement. It's a much deeper requirement which includes to identify, to prevent, to mitigate, and to account for your activities, and to look at the consequences for those who are stakeholders, particularly communities on the ground. So having a corporate social responsibility policy is not enough. There needs to be much greater engagement in this area. It's an area for which there's still developing practices, but it's important to consider that. And as I say, this is a Guiding Principle 15 makes it clear. Those are the elements that need to be required for due diligence. Of course, it might be possible to argue that if you undertake human rights due diligence, then you have a defence. Not quite so simple. If it's your own actions, or the company has done it themselves, it is probably not a defence. If it's through a third party, let's say a supply chain, and you've done human rights due diligence, it may well be a defence. Once again, this area is very much developing. There's a couple of examples that come out of, say, the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act in the US, but not a lot yet to know where this is going. But I think there's a very strong chance this will be litigated much, much more. And finally, the issue of grievance mechanisms in terms of one of the responsibilities. Grievance mechanisms, I think, should be taken very seriously by companies, by NGOs, by governments. Because if companies put in place good and effective grievance mechanisms, it may not lead to litigation. But if they're ineffective or there are other means to get away without engaging with the real human rights issues, then they are very problematic. But this is a core area which companies have not yet really begun to engage in. So what could I say would be the influences of the UN Guiding Principles? Paul's already mentioned a few, in particular in relation to legislation. Let me just briefly mention a few others. Access to finances. Crucial if you're engaging in investment in Africa is you need access to finances. What's happening is the UN Guiding Principles are seeping into other requirements. The Equator Principles, which are the banks, private banks' approach to project finance, require now that a company has a human rights impact assessment. Not just an environmental assessment, but a human rights impact assessment before that finance will be given. So I think that is quite a developing area. Also, the IMF performance standards are requiring this. And there's a recent case in the US before the Court of Appeals Second Circuit called Mustafa, in which BNP, a bank, was being held potentially responsible for financing a situation which led to a human rights abuse. That was in relation to sanctions. So there is this aspect of finances. Secondly, peer pressure. It may sound a strange one, but actually many of the sectors are beginning to put together best practices, are beginning to coordinate, to work together ways in which the corporations should be acting together in the particular sector. And in some ways, this is part of Paul's comment about the good business case for engaging in this issue. It's a very strong business case. The next area is in relation to codes of conduct. If you have a supply chain, a value chain, both ways, that's an area which is becoming of more interest in terms of the activities and the responsibilities of corporations. Rana Plaza in Bangladesh was an example where it was suddenly very clear that corporations such as Walmart, such as Primart, were not really taking notice of what their supply chain was doing, with significant consequences. This is a huge growth area in terms of what the companies need to put in place in their contracts and in terms of compliance. And the final area, of course, is the development of case law. Massive development of case law, slow in some countries, much quicker in others, but it's an area which I think we need to be alert to in the influences generally. So where would I conclude from this? Well, I guess the key thing is there are risks. This is an area of significant risks. Those risks could be risks which are in relation to financial risks, that companies need to be aware of the sense of the financial risk. Those financial risks can be ones which are both in their operational sense. For example, if a company is not taking human rights into account, their operation may well be stopped because of strikes, because of activity, because of cutting oil pipelines, whatever. It is a real financial risk and an operational risk. And of course, a link to that is reputational risk. That company's reputation is going to be affected. And that reputation has many consequences, including financial consequences. And of course, the legal risk. The legal risk that the actions, which is abusive human rights, could be brought to court. Just to kind of finish on this to some extent, the Nike CEO, Philip Knight, said this: "We do not like the fact that the Nike product has become synonymous with slave wages, forced overtime and arbitrary abuse. That is the risk if companies don't begin engaging with this." And in some ways, the problem is, unless there's that engagement, the risks escalate, both within the states involved, but also, of course, for the companies in other locations. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. Emily McKenzie.
Thanks, Richard. So I'm going to talk about investment treaty arbitration and human rights, which is a bit of a change of topic to what we've been talking about so far. And I think the starting point for that discussion has to be to reiterate Harry's warning of this morning, which is to say that Africa is such a large continent of 54 or possibly 55 jurisdictions, with huge economic and legal variations between them. And so it's very difficult to say anything generalized, particularly on a topic as controversial as investment and human rights. And having inserted that health warning, I'm immediately going to ignore it and say something very generalized indeed, which is to say that there has been a widespread encouragement and therefore proliferation of international investment across the African continent in certainly the last 20 years and possibly well before that. And that what has naturally come with that is the insertion into the African legal order of the traditional mechanisms of international investment law. And the starting point there really is to think about bilateral investment treaties. There's been a huge number of these entered into by African states. It's very hard to know the exact number, but I recently heard an estimate that put it at around 820. Although we should bear in mind there are very striking regional differences in that four out of the top five states in terms of the number of bilateral investment treaties entered into are located in North Africa. Bilateral investment treaties, just to say briefly what they are treaties between two states which provide protection when investors from one state invest in the other. And those protections are normally surround obligations of fair and equitable treatment, protection from expropriation, and most relevantly for this discussion, they usually also contain what are known as investor-state dispute settlement clauses. These are clauses that allow any claims arising under the treaty to go to arbitration, what's known as investment treaty arbitration. And it's that type of clause that has particularly led to the increase in engagement with multinational treaties in Africa and around the world that underpin that arbitration system. And the most common is probably the ICSID convention. And again, we do see regional differences in terms of the take-up of that convention, but it's generally been pretty high. There's a particular prominence, again, of North Africa, Egypt being the most commonly named respondent state in Africa. And in fact, Egypt was named six times in 2013 alone, which is a relatively high frequency. Having said that, there's strong engagement all over the continent with the ICSID convention, and I think it's only six states in sub-Saharan Africa, for example, that have neither signed nor ratified that convention. So I think it is safe to conclude, speaking generally, that there has been a growth of investment treaty arbitration across the continent, bearing in mind the regional differences that I've mentioned. And that's important because in recent years, worldwide, we've seen what you might describe as a groundswell of concern about investment treaty arbitration and its role in the international legal order. So what sort of concerns are we talking about? I might loosely lump them into two categories. The first is what you could describe as rule of law concerns. There are multiple things about investment treaty arbitration that give rise to these sorts of concerns, but perhaps the most prominent, that's most often mentioned, is the lack of transparency in the system. So, for example, the OECD estimates that up to a third of investment treaty arbitration decisions are not published at all. The hearings are very often conducted in private, and the whole occurrence of the event may itself be private. There's also a problem with inconsistency of decisions in that there's no system of precedent, and that sort of goes hand in hand with the first point I made. If you don't have reporting of cases, you can't necessarily have consistency of decision making. And there's also an issue with the consistency with which awards can be enforced, which entirely depends on the local legal system. So that's the first set of concerns. The second set we might loosely describe as substantive concerns. And that really is that these types of arbitrations allow investors to challenge measures that they do have a negative impact on investment, but they also pursue important state objectives. So, for example, consumer protection, labor standards, environmental regulation, and most relevantly for what I want to talk about, human rights. So the question as to whether investment treaty arbitration is perhaps another forum to add to Robert's list of forums where companies can be held to account for a failure to respect human rights, and that's a very interesting question. But one case I want to explore very briefly suggests that currently the answer to that is probably no, or at least unlikely. And that is the Bywater Gulf case against Tanzania, which was an ICSID arbitration decided in 2008. And it's important to bear in mind when reading what is, without any question, a very long arbitration award here, that Tanzania at the time was ranked by the IMF as the 26th poorest nation in the world, where 13% of all deaths were attributed to poor sanitation and water supply. And the Tanzanian government had been attempting to, in particular, to secure safe water for its major population center of Dar es Salaam. And in 2003, it decided to privatize that provision in an attempt to improve the situation. So it granted a 10-year lease to Bywater Gulf, a company with some British roots, and therefore the bilateral investment treaty between Great Britain and Tanzania applied to the investment. Now, so it turned out, Bywater Gulf's performance was even worse than the government agency that had previously been running the system. And I mean, you really have to read the arbitration award to understand just how damning an indictment the arbitrators made of the performance of the company in this regard. The government attempted to renegotiate the lease, and that failed. And so it terminated the contract and took over the water supply in an attempt to avert what was already a very serious humanitarian crisis. And Bywater Gulf brought an arbitration claim under the ICSID rules. And various NGOs were permitted to make submissions in that arbitration, which concerned various aspects, but most interestingly, perhaps, the right to water and to sanitation, which is a recognised human right, an economic and social right. And the NGOs argued that when an investor chooses to invest in water provision in a developing country, their investment cannot be viewed in isolation as an ordinary type of commercial investment, because it has sustainable development and human rights implications very tightly entwined with it. And so the investor should be seen as encumbering itself with responsibilities as regards the protection of the most essential and basic human rights. And at the very least, the consequences of a catastrophic failure in that regard should be at least relevant to the arbitration decision and to the award that's made. Now, although those submissions, they were permitted to be made, which in itself was quite novel at the time, they seemingly had no impact on the award itself. Tanzania's actions were found to be unlawful and to have breached the bilateral investment treaty. And it's true that no compensation was awarded to Bywatergauff, but that was not because of these human rights concerns that had been raised. It was for just classic investment law reasons, particularly that the company had a nil value at the date of the argued expropriation and that they have failed to prove the relevant causation. So that's one example that demonstrates the types of concerns that people have raised when it comes to human rights and investment treaty arbitration. But how does that pattern of growing concern play out across the African continent? Well, I think it's fair to say that South Africa has taken the most striking position in this regard. And that, that really came about with a slightly different type of human rights case. And that happened when South Africa set about reforming its constitutional arrangements after apartheid. It passed a multitude of legislation designed to pursue equality in various different ways. And that included, in particular, laws that required mining companies to be partly owned by historically disadvantaged persons. And it found itself faced with ICSID claims brought by European countries under BITs that challenged those very laws. And whether or not those claims were successful is perhaps beside the point. South Africa, at least, certainly felt that the very fact that there was a forum where those types of claims could be brought went to the very core of its constitutional transformation. And so it conducted a comprehensive review of its bilateral investment treaty obligations, a sort of risk assessment, if you like. And it's published a very interesting report. And there's been a lot of discussion about this. But essentially, the findings were that bilateral investment treaties posed risks and limitations on the ability of the government to pursue its constitutional transformation agenda. It found that the bits that had been signed were relatively one-sided, and that they'd been signed at a time when there was little internal understanding of international investment law in the host state. And so it's decided to pull out of its bits, or at least when they come up for renegotiation, not to re-sign them. And instead, it's currently passing the Promotion and Protection of Investment Bill through Parliament, which will provide protection for investors, but very much in a domestic setting, thoroughly grounded in the new South African constitution. And importantly, there's no investor state dispute settlement in there. The investors will have to use domestic courts. South Africa, I don't think, is particularly concerned about capital flight as a result of that. In fact, the review found that they have more capital inflow from countries where they have no bilateral investment treaty concluded with that country. And whether other countries would have the same experience is, of course, a difficult question to answer. We've seen similar concerns expressed by other countries on the continent, but most notably Namibia, and certainly in other regions and countries around the world, particularly the Latin American region and Indonesia. And also importantly, the African institutions appear to have responded quite strongly to some of these concerns and have published model bilateral investment treaties. Particularly, there's one published by the Southern African Development Community and one for the Common Investment Area of COMESA. And most these have lots of different, very interesting provisions in them, but perhaps the most interesting for this talk is that they impose obligations on investors to provide minimum protection for human rights. It is a minimum obligation, and it's an obligation of effort, not achievement, perhaps not dissimilar to the principles that Paul and Robert discussed. But I think the interesting thing is that if you impose an obligation in the treaty itself, you might bypass that problem in Bywater Gulf, where the human rights issues, they just didn't bite. Because the model bilateral investment treaties suggest that if there's a failure as regards these respect for these minimum investor obligations, the tribunal must consider whether the breach of that obligation is materially relevant to the issue before it, and if so, what mitigating or offsetting effects it should have on the merits of the claim itself or on any damages award. Now, the limitation of that is that very few countries have taken up that model. It's not really being used yet. And also, we see a lot of very economically prominent countries, such as Nigeria and Egypt, not really changing or seeming to change their attitude to bilateral investment treaties or an appetite to adopt these kinds of provisions. So I think the stage is really open in this regard. There's a trend that could really go either way, and we could potentially end up with very stark differences, state by state or region by region, as to what sort of protection investors get, whether they use arbitration or domestic systems, and what sort of human rights guarantees the local population can expect from investors investing in their local communities. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Emily. Andrew McIntyre.
Good morning. International criminal law is not something that comes up very much in day-to-day practice for most of us. But understanding how the International Criminal Court responds, or indeed doesn't respond, to mass human rights violations is helpful in understanding the scope of protection of human rights in Africa more generally. By way of background, the International Criminal Court was established by the Rome Statute in 2002. It follows in the footsteps of a number of ad hoc tribunals established to deal with specific historical events, beginning with the International Military Tribunal at Nuremberg. Unlike its predecessors, the ICC is a permanent court with general jurisdiction over the most serious international crimes. Also, unlike its predecessors, it is a court of last resort. It cannot usurp the jurisdiction of national judicial authorities. It can only intervene where a state is itself unwilling and unable to investigate or prosecute an offence. The ICC has jurisdiction over crimes falling into three categories. First of all, genocide, which encompasses a number of offences committed with intent to destroy in whole or in part a national, ethnical, racial, or religious group. Secondly, crimes against humanity, the key feature of which is that they are committed as part of a widespread or systematic attack directed against any civilian population. And thirdly, war crimes, which comprise various offences committed within the context of an internal or international armed conflict. There are three ways in which a case can come before the ICC. First, a state party to the Rome Statute can refer a situation in which a crime appears to have been committed either by a national of a state party or on the territory of a state party. The negotiating texts show that this was originally envisaged as a mechanism for states party to tell tales on each other. But in fact, nothing in the language of the Rome Statute prevents a state party from referring a crime committed on its own territory or by one of its own nationals. And somewhat unexpectedly, that is exclusively how this provision has been used to date. The second route to jurisdiction is through the UN Security Council, which can refer a situation to the court regardless of where or by whom the crimes appear to have been committed. And the third route is through the prosecutor herself, who can initiate a preliminary examination of her own motion, although the court's pre-trial chamber must give its consent before the case can progress to the formal investigation stage. In the handout that accompanies this talk, I describe the operation of these mechanisms and the court's procedures more generally. But what I want to focus on today is the court's record in Africa. And it's important to begin by saying that participation in the Rome Statute in Africa is relatively good. 34 of the 54 fully recognized states in Africa are party to the Rome Statute, as compared to, for example, 19 of 49 states in Asia. In the last few years, however, it's become a common refrain that the court has an Africa problem. The accusation, as it's usually put, is one of bias or selective justice. 9 of the 9 formal investigations begun by the court have taken place in Africa. Both of the individuals convicted by the court to date have been Africans. All 38 of the 38 persons currently under indictment are African. Clearly, it's no longer possible to justify this selectivity, if ever it was, by reference simply to the geography of conflict. But I would suggest that it doesn't follow that the court is affected by some inherent bias. To a large extent, the ICC is in Africa by invitation. Of the 9 situations under investigation, you can see from the table, 5 were self-referrals. Another one in the Ivory Coast was not formally a self-referral, but it was begun at the request of the president, Alassane Ouattara. Even the investigation in Kenya, which is, strictly speaking, a discretionary investigation, was a borderline self-referral in that it emerged from a power-sharing agreement brokered by Kofi Annan. To the extent that there is a reluctance to deal with crimes outside Africa, the problem lies further upstream at the level of the Security Council. A resolution referring the situation in Syria to the ICC was vetoed by Russia and China last year. Russia and China have also made it clear that they will veto any attempt to refer North Korea to the ICC. The UK and the USA have in the past voted against a proposal to consider referring the situation in Palestine to the ICC. The question might then be, why has the prosecutor not used her own discretionary power to fill the regional gap left by the Security Council? But in fact, as you can see, she has. When you look at the list of preliminary examinations initiated by the prosecutor, the picture you see is geographically more balanced. In time, I think that we can expect to see the court expand its reach, although, of course, international justice tends to be anything but swift. However, that is not the end of it, because the ICC does have a slightly less obvious, but still very pernicious problem in Africa, and one which risks undermining its credibility and independence. In Uganda, the DRC, the CAR, the Ivory Coast, and Mali, the court has indicted exclusively non-state actors, in other words, rebel leaders and warlords. No charges have been laid against sitting members of government in those countries. If you take that list and lay it against the previous table, it's not a coincidence that those are the same 5 countries that referred themselves to the ICC. In Uganda, for example, the focus of the ICC's investigation has exclusively been on the leaders of the Lord's Resistance Army. And there's no doubt that the LRA was responsible for some horrific acts in Uganda. But the Ugandan government forces did not come out of that very long conflict with clean hands either. You can readily understand why the court focuses on non-state actors. The ICC's record of pursuing incumbent political leaders is abysmal. We've seen that very recently, for example, with President Kenyatta of Kenya and President al-Bashir of Sudan. But that is not because of prosecutorial partiality. It is simply because the Rome Statute gives the court no supporting structure in the UN. In other words, in order to gather evidence or even effect arrests, the ICC relies on the cooperation of states. And what we've seen to date is that when investigations hit too close to home, states party simply disengage. The result is that the ICC is too often being used to mete out a form of victor's justice. You might well say that if the goal is to end impunity, then victor's justice is better than no justice. But in the long run, taking sides in internal conflicts in Africa robs the court of its credibility, and it only makes it harder for it to establish itself as a genuinely impartial arbiter, as opposed to, as is sometimes said, an instrument of neocolonialism. That, I would suggest, is the ICC's real Africa problem. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew. Eva Thorne.
I'm conscious that I'm the only thing standing between you and coffee, so I'm going to try to be efficient in my comments and leave time for discussion. So I'm going to talk about the experience of Liberia in terms of its petroleum reform, which began in the year 2012 and is in the process of wrapping up now. So just by way of some relevant background, the exploration acreage in Liberia is all offshore. There are 13 ultra-deep and 17 deep blocks. Why that's important is that there are only a relatively small handful of companies that are able to do that kind of drilling, the technological sophistication, the financial means. Most of them tend to be Western, so we're talking primarily about the supermajors, plus companies such as Statoil, some of the smaller but rising independents such as Tullo and Kosmos, which are responsible for the Jubilee find in offshore Ghana, and companies such as Petrobras in Brazil, which has a huge series of blocks that are offshore, pre-salt, very, very deep, and also Petronas in Malaysia. So when you're talking about those kinds of companies, primarily the Western ones, they already tend to have higher standards and norms embedded in their policies and practices with respect to human rights. One other relevant point to make is that in the year 2014, Liberia had a competitive bid round for 4 offshore blocks. Block 6 and 7 closer to the border with Ivory Coast, block 16 and 17 out near the border with Sierra Leone. And the relevant point here, and I worked on the bid round as well, is that the model production sharing contract that was used was a hybrid of the Exxon Block 13 contract, which was signed in 2013, and elements from the new model production sharing contract were incorporated into that. So it was a hybrid of Block 13, the new one that's going to be passed in a couple of months. And significantly, we spent a lot of time with oil companies getting their comments and their observations about the model production sharing contract, and some of the norms around human rights that are embedded in the new Petroleum Act come out in the model PSC for the bid round, and they were very well received by the companies, and we didn't have any major challenges from them. So I'd like to make a few comments now about the institutions, setting the stage for where this sector was when the petroleum reform started. So at the time, we're talking about exploration acreage that was in transition. So there were still a few of the briefcase companies that entered the acreage under the Taylor regime or before, but weren't able to actually conduct any drilling. There were a few credible international oil companies by 2012 when President Ellen Johnson Sirleaf announced the reform. So Chevron had 3 blocks, blocks 11, 12, and 14, and then what's believed to be the jewel in the crown if you listen to industry reports, Exxon in block 13, which signed in 2013, and significantly for a frontier market, Exxon paid the government of Liberia an unheard of upfront signature bonus of $50 million, which you do not get with acreage where you don't have commercial discoveries. So with respect to the institutions that anchored the sector at the time of the reform in 2012, we are talking about the National Oil Company of Liberia. And the National Oil Company of Liberia played all roles, the regulatory role. It was a commercial entity, so taking stakes in production sharing contracts, and it was supposed to have a policy-making function, but in the year 2000, when NOCAL was created under the NOCAL Act, we didn't really have any policy to speak of. The anchoring legislation was the Petroleum Act of 2002, and the material point to surround these two anchoring institutions is that both came on stream during the era of Charles Taylor. So Liberia finished its civil war in the year 2003. There was a two-year interim government under Jude Bryant, which was a bit of a disaster. And then President Johnson Sirleaf comes to power in 2005 and again in 2011. So the institutions in 2000, 2001, 2002 under Charles Taylor reflect the era. And so I'll say more about how that comes out in terms of the law, but we're not talking about a lot of progressive human rights norms embedded either in the NOCAL Act or in the 2002 Petroleum Act. So all of that changes in the year 2012. So Ellen Johnson Sirleaf is in her second term. She comes to power in what are viewed as free and fair elections. And she comes to power on a platform of reconciliation, rebuilding the country with a particular focus on infrastructure. And she comes from a very kind of Western-oriented background, having served in Citibank, having worked in the World Bank, and was extremely open to these kinds of institutions, which is important because those norms find their way into some of the legal institutions that ground the reform. So in 2012, she announced that there were three objectives for the petroleum reform. First, to help Liberia attract world-class companies, so moving away from these less credible briefcase companies to the larger, more credible ones. And that was by design, to help Liberia build its knowledge, build its capacity, embed some of these norms in the public sector institutions that are responsible for the petroleum sector. And the second objective was about having a balanced petroleum governance framework. So I mentioned before that Exxon provided a $50 million upfront bonus, which was unheard of for a frontier market. One of the challenges that frontier markets have in Africa is that they're unknown, they don't have commercial discovery, and so these countries are in the tough position of having to attract investors. So they're legal and regulatory frameworks tend to tilt toward investors with fewer benefits accruing to the state. So one of the challenging objectives that the president set out was to make sure that there were good benefits to the state with respect to revenues, not just in terms of upfront signature bonuses, although that was certainly important. And then secondly, to make sure that the regime was fiscal terms were attractive enough for foreign investors coming in. And then there were these other kind of related points that I made here. And then in terms of the actual petroleum law, the legal framework, she was very explicit in wanting the framework to take into account issues such as transparency, inclusion, participation, favoring disclosure of information, favoring involvement of the Liberian public. So there are four elements of the legal framework for the reform. The first was a petroleum policy that was passed in 2012. I arrived in Liberia early in 2013, although I went in 2012 at the invitation of the government, and I was fortunate enough to do a presentation to the president and the cabinet on some of the high-level strategic issues that I thought needed to be considered, and to do some technical sessions with the National Oil Company of Liberia, and I was deeply, deeply impressed that however challenging the environment was for the petroleum policy, that it was incredibly inclusive. And the policy involved the participation of everyday Liberians from all walks of life. The discussions were held in 15 counties, all 15 counties in Liberia, in Monrovia, which is the capital and the political hotbed of the country, and internationally with a very, very vocal, very contentious, fractious, loud, boisterous, involved Liberian overseas citizens that were involved in the process. So the petroleum policy was also vetted by civil society groups such as Natural Resources Governance Institution, they'll always be Revenue Watch to me, and other civil society groups as well. There's also, as I mentioned, in terms of the 2014 bid round, the new model production sharing contract, that is will be published online, and what's significant there is that there will be very few biddable items, which is where you tend to have funny business happening in terms of transparency. And it's also important in terms of the ease of administering to have the same terms across all the production sharing contracts, which in the context of Liberia's earlier contracts was not the case. You had the contracts basically superseding the Petroleum Act of 2002, and with this new reform, as I'll talk about in a little bit, the law actually supersedes everything, including the individual contracts. There's a revised NOCAL Act, and the centerpiece of the reform is the 2013 Petroleum Act. And I should say that this whole edifice of institutions builds on the 2009 Liberia Extractive Industries Transparency Initiative, LETI, which I should say that Liberia is the first country to actually enshrine EITI as a law, and that law is carried through to the new petroleum reforms. So now, in terms of the 2002 petroleum law, I went through it in preparation for this discussion, and the three areas that struck me as most relevant for our discussion of human rights norms were around HSE provisions, compensation and dispute resolution, and issues around transparency. And I was actually surprised that there was more in the law than I thought there would be around environmental issues, although there is not a firm series of statements holding contractors liable. There is language around that, but the language in the new law is much, much stronger. So I won't go through all the specific features. You can see them there on the deck. There are provisions for people who lose their land to make way for pipelines or petroleum-related installations. And then significantly, under the third point, transparency, you see I have no bullet points there because I went through the document with a fine-tooth comb, and there's not a lot in that document that talks about transparency or inclusion or participation of civil society. And in fact, there are a number of statements in the 2002 Act that talk about documents and reports being confidential and just being disclosed between the contractor and NOCAL. Very, very different in terms of the 2002 Petroleum Act, which anchors the reform process. So there is separation of functions. So the centerpiece of this, which does have something to do with our discussion of transparency and accountability, splits up NOCAL. So NOCAL will retain the commercial function, which is managing the state's participation and managing a very innovative provision known as citizens' participation, where there's a 5% stake that will go into a fund for everyday Liberian citizens. The policymaking function will go to the Ministry of Lands, Mines, and Energy. And the regulatory function will go to a petroleum authority, which will be semi-autonomous. And at commercial discovery, the petroleum authority will fall under the jurisdiction of a new Ministry of Petroleum, assuming that commercial discovery happens in Liberia. So this was to provide some measure of checks and balances, but of course the flip side of the challenge is building the capacity of all these new institutions. In terms of licensing and contracting, there's a requirement for competitive bidding, which is very good. Lots of transparency measures there in terms of publication of the tender protocol, pre-qualification requirements, publication of the regulator's report, et cetera, all available for public consumption. Under the circumstances where there are direct negotiations, the regulator would appoint a bid team that's divided across the different ministries that are related to the sector in consultation with the president. One of the more innovative measures in terms of the bid evaluation panel is that there is a provision in the draft 2013 Act for someone from LETI, the Liberian Extractives Transparency Initiative, to actually sit on the bid panel. And there was even a provision, and I'm not sure if it's made it into the final version, to have an international expert sit. And again, that is to ensure transparency and accountability. So in going through this process and accompanying it over the past couple of years in Liberia, I've been very, very impressed by the seriousness of the commitments to get this good governance, transparency, human rights norms, to get those issues correct and to get them embedded in these legal institutions anchoring the reform. So, as I said, there is the framework favors disclosure of information, transparency. So publication, as I mentioned, of assessments, protocols, decisions to open up new areas for exploration, any kinds of impacts that those decisions will make, publication of the agreements, et cetera, will all be made available, and public hearings as well. The next phase in the reform, once the regulator is up and running, and that should be sometime, I'm guessing, this fall or winter, the next phase will be in writing the regulations. And so there will be public hearings on the proposed regulations, as well as consultations for environmental and social impact assessments. I should say that I think a key reason why you see the incorporation of so many norms around transparency, anti-corruption, accountability, and human rights is because you had the involvement of the World Bank, which provided technical assistance in the form of a legal consultant, and the legal consultant, along with support from ISLP, who's mentioned here in the conference as one of your organizations that you're supporting, provided some support for the development of this legal framework. So all of those norms kind of inform what you see here in terms of the framework. So other provisions that are relevant to our discussion today include compensation for damages, a much more developed and robust rendering of it in the new laws compared to the old one. And a very, very well-developed section in the new law has to do with spelling out HSE issues with clear liability for the contractor, for the IOC, requirements for spelled out and well-specified emergency preparedness plans. And interestingly, I didn't see this in the 2002 law, but you know, of course, we always think of the Niger Delta. No flaring except under very, very specific circumstances. So a lot of care was taken in this law in terms of taking seriously issues of worker safety, health, and the environment. Liberia is very, very dependent in some measures on its fishing industry, and since all the exploration acreage is offshore, I think these issues took on greater importance. I want to make three conclusions, but I want to make two observations that came up for me in light of my fellow panelists' comments. The first is that I think extractive industries are a particular kind of company, and the effects of oil, gas, and mining projects are obvious, very, very strong, and they tend to be immediate. And so my observation from working with the industry and observing from the perspective of government and civil society is that extractive industries tend to be a little bit more conscious of the kinds of human rights norms that we're talking about, whether or not they're implemented in practice on a consistent basis. The second observation that I want to make that sparked by my panelists is that in the 2 years, just under 2 years that I spent in Liberia, I never heard human rights mentioned in explicit terms. But the norms, the values, the ideas are all there, even though you don't get it talked about in human rights explicit language. So by way of conclusion, I have three. The first is that it's pretty obvious that the 2013 petroleum law and the associated legal framework is a major advance over what you have from 2002 to the credit of the government. And I think it reflects a few things that maybe we could bring out in some of the discussion. It reflects political leadership at the top in terms of President Ellen Johnson Sirleaf, and it also, in my view, looking at Liberia's trajectory since the end of the Civil War, it reflects regime change, and it reflects the process of democratization and a real openness to these progressive international norms. The second point is that implementation of the law is not a given, and that's not meant in a negative way. Liberia is one of the poorest countries in the world. I think it came out as one of the fourth, maybe the fourth poorest country a few years ago. And these institutions are great on paper, but they require capabilities, they require capacity building, they require support for them to be fully implemented. So this is something that's underway. So building capacity in the regulator, building capacity in the sector-related institutions. And it will happen with continued senior leadership support on the domestic political front, as well as international technical assistance. And then I think the broader political context is going to be key to seeing how the sector develops and how these laws are actually implemented. There's going to be a presidential election in 2017. And I think some of how the sector develops will depend on who comes to power and how these issues play out in that context. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Eva. Even on African time, we're 2 minutes over time at the moment. But having said that, it seems to me that this is such an important topic, and this is probably the most crowded session we're going to have, that you would feel cheated if we didn't have some discussion. So I'm going to claim 5 minutes at least, and I hope I'm not going to get negative comments. There are a lot of people in this audience who have specialist knowledge, and I can see around the room many who have practiced in Africa, some who are directors of foundations that combat corruption, and indeed that are fully aware of the links between business and human rights. Let me ask you if you have any questions from any of the panelists, bearing in mind the themes that seem to me at least to have emerged from the very interesting talks that we've had. The proposition that there is a business case for expanded human rights, the proposition that there is a moral case reinforced perhaps by the obvious fact of peer pressure if those norms are not conformed to, the proposition that if you get a reformist government with a will, you are likely to get expanded human rights laws, but also the proposition that unless these aspects of developing collective action are appreciated by publicity, I take this from Emily's talk, we may not make much progress in terms of any consistent development of human rights throughout Africa. Anyway, with those very inchoate thoughts, any questions? Yes, gentleman there. And perhaps you could introduce yourself. I was hoping we had a roving mic, and we actually do. Excellent.
Just a quick question for Robert. Sorry, is that better?
Yeah, that's fine.
Just on the UN guiding principles and national action plans, maybe just a quick thought on how African states are doing in terms of developing national action plans.
Do you want to answer that, Robert?
Oh, sure.
We'll take them one by one.
Okay. Thank you, Stuart. The sad thing is how few states have actually undertaken the National Action Plan, which is a plan suggested by the UN Working Group on Business and Human Rights, where each state should set out what their responses are to it. With the exception of Tanzania, which has done a form of National Action Plan, albeit it's not necessarily sure it's final, no African state has yet actually produced a National Action Plan. And that's a pity, and I think what it requires is some capacity building by the industrialized states to actually assist them in that provision, because without that, there's no incentive necessary to undertake regulation, which in the long term is a better position rather than relying on actions taken in the European states.
Yes. There's a question, I think, from a gentleman there.
It's a question to Emily. Apart from the obvious cases of agreement by parties to renegotiate BITs, is there any scope for a review or revision of the existing BITs by either of the parties?
Thank you. I think that the problem when you're talking about BITs is that it very much depends on the BIT itself and the terms of that agreement. So it's really can only be taken on a case-by-case basis. Usually they have built into them a term after which they can be abandoned or renegotiated. And it can be quite difficult prior to reaching that term just unilaterally to pull out of them. But I think the South African example is a very interesting one where there has been such a comprehensive review and all the BITs have been looked at as to what their terms are and where it's possible to move away from them. Immediately that's being done, and otherwise it's being done in a staggered way that respects the rule of law and the impact of those on national policy. Thank you.
Yes, question at the back there, please.
Yeah. I'm Shehu Mustafa, I practice law in Lagos. One of the things Emily spoke about towards the tail end was about implementation, and I think that's perhaps one of the most important things. A lot of times there are nice laws made on paper, but they just end there. It's either there's no will or there's no capacity to implement and enforce. So, I mean, what I have is just by way of commentary to encourage that. I see much of the focus is on lawmaking and rulemaking, and I think an equal focus should shift to implementation and enforcement.
Yeah, we speak of the rule of law. I know that Sir Sidney Kentridge dislikes the phrase enormously because, really taking your point up, that law can be a bad law or an inadequate law, and he would prefer to substitute the rule of justice, but whether that aids the question any further, I'm not sure. Any other questions? Right at the front here, second row. If we have the roving mic, that would be great. Thank you. I'm told this must be the last question.
Thank you. George Bennett from the Brecon Group. We consult on human rights and security issues. Robert, a question. You mentioned the Equator Principles and the IFC performance standards. Could you give me a view on the level, your assessment of the level of implementation currently and in the near future of those, in the context that, for example, both Marikana and Simandou, two mining projects, are in fact IFC sponsored projects, which doesn't necessarily reflect particularly well on the performance standards implementation. Thank you.
Thank you. It's a fair question. Just to give the context, the IFC, which is part of the World Bank, have these performance standards, which are necessary for a ability to get finances for certain sectors, such as you mentioned, for example, the Marikana case, which was in South Africa and Johannesburg, and it was shown that the performance standards were simply not being complied with. The difficulty is the implementation, which is, I guess, the question further. But to go back a stage, when those performance standards were being undertaken, they didn't yet have the human rights requirement, which is now in the Equator Principles, which only changed in 2013. So we don't yet have enough history to see whether or not having a human rights standard as against an environmental standard, which was part of the performance standards, will make that change. And I think that it links with Emily. If the issue of finances is taken seriously in human rights, actually it'll begin to help determine this balance between an investment policy looking to attract foreign direct investment and a human rights policy, so that actually there's a degree to which the two can fit together, because they're certainly not at the moment. The investment is driving it. Just to flag perhaps a different angle on that, I was recently in Geneva for the debate about whether there should be a treaty about business and human rights. And the pressure, interestingly enough, for that is coming from Ecuador, South Africa, and a range, particularly Latin American states, to push for that treaty. But the problem is there's still not the acceptance. The state itself needs to have some regulation on that, for which they can then engage with those in the investment community.
Thanks, Robert. It only remains for me to thank all the panellists for extremely interesting talks, and to you for listening so intently and for raising such interesting questions. Thank you very much.